started using mini educator on stim with prong in the last week. Dog's healing perfectly. He trots right next to me with head up looking at me. I think he's looking for praise. When I look down, he either gets a good rub on the head. Anything further I should be doing to reward this awesome behavior? He's totally looking for my approval constantly.
So Jillian, now, you know, I mean, this is the thing. I think it's a little bit hard for your average pet dog trainer and pet to do food training right then and there. I think, and telling your dog, like, when I put it this way, Jillian, here's a great example. When your dog's in a room and you're not in the room and you walk into the room, does your dog get excited? Does it wag its tail? You just showing up is a reward. Always remember that. So your presence is a reward. So what I'd like you to do is absolutely just tell him, good boy. It's a boy or a girl. It doesn't say, but you know, good dog, good boy, good girl. Do that. Just say, that's a good boy. Give him a little bit of a head thing. You can do that. That's a good boy. Do that.
Okay. That exact tone of voice.
I want you to make that your ringtone. Ready? Ready, Jillian? Make that your ringtone. That's a good boy.
Oh my God. Got it? I feel nightmares.
Let's do that.
All right.
Yeah. Here we are. We're live. We got sound. I got things. Test the sound.
I don't know.
Test your sound. Turn your sound up. Hey, everybody. How are you? Up? Nope. That's a commercial. Hey, everybody. How's everybody doing? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Welcome to the show. What's tonight?
It is Wednesday.
Wednesday night on YouTube Live. Hey, everybody on Spotify, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, on Google, a bunch of other different sound platforms. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm really, really excited that we've got another fantastic show with fantastic questions. We do a 90-minute show historically on Wednesday nights, and I want to just thank everybody for showing up and everybody on YouTube Live, and if you're watching the replay on YouTube as well, that's fantastic. The way it works is you'll be able to ask your questions. You've got a little question box down underneath your name at the bottom right corner, at least on my laptop and phone. You've got it. Where's the questions? At the very, very bottom of your screen on your phone is where you can ask the questions. And what you'll do is I'll answer any question on pretty much on dog training. I don't do vet stuff and medical stuff and grooming stuff. Every once in a while, someone throws that in there and they want to know my advice on that. And I really can't answer that question. But I've got a training center up in Providence, Rhode Island. I personally tour the world doing dog training seminars. One of the things that we're really, really good at is we're really good at behavior modification, stopping aggression, high-level leash reactivity, separation anxiety, and a lot of unwanted behaviors. A lot of the people are drawn towards this show. A lot of people are drawn towards my seminars because they want to learn how to properly stop an unwanted behavior. I would say that about 90% of dog trainers out there don't know how to do that. And the reason is because they don't know how to properly apply punishment. You know, a lot of folks, they like to throw around catchwords, which we don't do on this show at all, positive reinforcement. And then a lot of folks will preach and scream and yell, never say no to your dog, never punish your dog, never do something to your dog that it might not like. Unfortunately, you're not going to be able to stop an unwanted behavior and you're going to be left struggling. So there's a lot of unethical behavior out there. There's a lot of outright blatant lies out there where people are saying that you never have to say no to your dog or punish your dog. Remember, proper punishment is not involved yelling or screaming, or you're not mad, you're not angry. It's just the proper application of punishment. So you can hear me use that word a lot tonight. And if you're brand new to the show, you'll think, geez, all this guy does is talk about punishing dogs. Well, it's like everybody keeps asking me how to stop an unwanted behavior. I said, that's what the answer is. I said, I got to answer the question. But if you go to our training center, you'll see that a lot of what we do, in fact, most of our day is actually rewarding dogs. There hasn't been a dog out there that we haven't been able to help dramatically. Some dogs obviously don't get up to the level of expectation that we want, because there's some really challenging dogs out there. We're going to talk for a little bit right now. So let's get your questions down below. And Joelle is going to start asking the questions. Here we go.
Lou, when working with a dog that is leash reactive, how frequently do you need to work the dog around other dogs for the training to be effective?
Try it, Lou. Try it until it's done. So how many times does a 18-month-old have to stand up and fall until they can walk? Until they do. So there's no number. The goal of the training is you do it until it works, but it shouldn't take you years. So there's a lot of variables. Number one, how knowledgeable are you about how to stop an unwanted behavior? Number one, can you train a dog to do a proper heel? Number two, do you understand arousal? Do you understand the proper application of punishments? Are you using the proper tools to have success? And how much experience do you have? So there's a lot of variables there, but you know, it takes thousands of repetitions to train a reliable command usually. So stopping an unwanted behavior, you can stop the unwanted behavior sometimes in seconds, but now to really get the dog to fully comprehend it and understand it and want to do well, that could always take a little bit longer. It's sort of like rehab. Think about rehab for drug and alcohol. Some people respond really quickly. Some people it takes longer, and some people also relapse. So there's a lot of variables there, a lot of variables. Also, there's a little button at the bottom with a dollar sign, dollar, dollar, make you holler. If you click on that button, it's pretty cool. You can actually do something called the super chat. Super chat, it sends a highlighted message. It goes right up to the top of the chat. You also throw us a little bit of cash for all the free help. We've got about 5,000 videos, 10,000 hours of audio content out there. A lot of people have been fully training their dogs with our content, and they really appreciate that. So they'll throw us super chat money. Next.
Katie Cat. Hey, guys. New mini educator has worked great with crate shenanigans, but my dog now shakes and cowers at the word kennel. Will she work through this solo? Anything I can do to help? Thanks.
Well, the dog should be shaking, if anything, at the word no, not kennel. So what you're doing is, I'm glad you figured it out. Now let's turn the kennel up into a really, really awesome thing. So the kennel is the command. The kennel is not the punisher word. So the punisher word should always be no. Kennel is just an obedience command. It means go into your kennel. It's possible that your dog now is associating the kennel with a not so great thing, but that's fine because your dog associated with a not so great thing before. What happens is a lot of the times when dogs are making outward motions of reactivity, of pawing at the crates, biting the crates, barking at the crates, slamming against the crate. We've seen dogs that break out of crates. They break their teeth. They harm their paws. What happens is when you stop that unwanted behavior, you're left with a really nervous dog. So your dog was always really, probably really, really nervous, but it was just acting it out, sort of like a bully does with its insecurity. Now you've got a dog that's stopped its unwanted behavior, and now you've got a dog that's left like going, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. So what I would do is I would do kennel up drills where we use food, we use clickers all the time, you know, kennel up, and then mark that with a clicker or with a yes, use a food reward if you want to, call the dog back out. Good job, lots of praise, send the dog back in, do lots of duration in the kennel, put the dog into downstays with the door open. This is when you're home, obviously, observing the dog, and you can do that. Next.
Steve N., struggling with pit pulling on prong, tried 180s and bonker, has ton of structure, knows obedience well, extended place and downs. His neck is between prong link sizes, maybe that's part of the problem. Using Herm Springer, it's either really tight behind his jaw and ears are too loose and slides down. When I add a link, he's been really leash reactive the week.
I doubt the prong sizing is what's creating the leash reactivity. You know, you might want to make it a little bit snug, or you might actually want to switch to a smaller gauge prong collar. If you haven't added a remote collar to the mix, remote collar really, really is going to help on your healing drills. I would recommend you teach remote collar heel, use the remote collar to eliminate the arousal. You can start doing, directional changes. What you might be doing is your timing might be a little bit off on your elimination of the arousal or the application of the punisher. A lot of times when the dog starts ramping up and then, we wait too long. And there's also challenging dogs out there. We've got this dog, Hank, that we're working with right now that came to us. That's the Doberman. It came to us with many, many, many reactivity issues, as well as redirecting on humans. The last thing that we are struggling with was squirrels. And the dog sees a squirrel and it just goes batshit crazy. And it's just like, we were able to eliminate everything else. And I were like, and also it starts nipping. So today the staff put a muzzle on him, and we like the basket muzzles. We don't like the nylon muzzles unless you're going to the vet and, you know, it's really quick, but a good basket muzzle, like from Baskerville, those are good for dogs can drink and they can take food and they can pants. And it's a practical working dog muzzle. That seemed to work. That seemed to work. Next.
Ellie Wynn. Hey, Jeff and Joel, finally able to tune in watching while at work.
Oh, awesome. Ellie. Hey, Ellie. Post things up at MIT. Nice. Thank you.
Christina, hi Jeff and Joelle. Should I teach place with an automatic down, or will that prevent my dog from repositioning during duration work?
No, I mean, you could. I mean, we do. I mean, and I don't mind a dog repositioning. You know what I mean? I don't expect dogs to be robots and just to sit there, to lie down there without moving. As far as like if they want to adjust their bodies, but we don't teach stand. So we do place. We started out with place, and then the dog sits. And then we teach the down, and then we make it the default. So we'll end up doing, so place actually means down. Go to the mat, go to the bed, go to the object, and lie down. Next.
Sunny Chen, any recommendation on confidence training at home?
Yeah, I mean, you can do just overall training is huge. Massive amounts of structure is great for confidence. Holding your dog accountable is great for confidence. You can go to some children's playgrounds on the off hours, use the children's playgrounds for different things, like, you know, all the different ramps and those, the bridges that move, the bridges that move, you know, around. You can do that. Food games are really, really good. Trick training is really, really good. But structure and holding your dog accountable helps with their confidence. And then cut down dramatically on affection. Next.
Megan Vance, ever had the e-collar box turn off mid-session? Happened 2 times at the most inopportune times.
The box on the dog's neck. Yeah, that's happened. It could be a faulty battery. Maybe it's not charging. That's definitely happened. So what I would do is I would call the manufacturer up, and you might have to swap out the battery on that. Right, next.
Ice-ski Big Sky. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Hope all is well.
Hey, Montana. How are you? Yep, things are fantastic. Thank you.
Emily, I've gotten weird people come up and knock on my front door. My dog barks when someone knocks, but stops when I check, which I like, but she's nervous, fearful when I actually have guests. Do I correct? I know that my dog isn't supposed to want to protect me, so I'm unsure. Thanks for all your help.
Well, there's two different things, nervous and fearful or protection. So what I would do is, when guests come over the house, just have your dog go to place, like go to a dog bed and lie down. Give your dog some more guidance or direction. So I don't mind a dog barking once at the door. But then when people come in the house, you can have your dog go lie down and like go to place, which is go to a dog bed or a mat or a you know, a piece of carpet square. It doesn't really, really matter what it is, or just go somewhere and lie down. And that's what we do. That's going to help dramatically, and just have the dog watch and observe the world go on. Next.
Bitless Equestrian. The thing is, we always have lots of kids running around at my house, and my 8-month border Aussie service dog in training will get super excited and bite them. Not super bad, but will leave a
scratch.
Yeah.
So first of all, Bitless Equestrian, your dog's not a service dog candidate. Okay. If your dog is exhibiting that behavior, just to give you a heads up. So a service dog candidate should never be doing that at all. So that doesn't mean you can't eliminate that, but I would make that, first of all, it is a huge issue. It's a humongous issue. I don't care if it leaves no mark or it leaves a scratch or it leaves a bite. It's all the same. Your service dog in training absolutely should not be exhibiting that behavior whatsoever at all. That dog should be learning how to ignore children and ignore environmentals. So what I want you to do is that dog should be on a leash. Right now, this is not the answer, but your dog shouldn't be able to have free access to kids in the house at all, because it doesn't get better at all. It only gets worse because you're allowing it to keep happening, which is why you tuned in. But what I would do, what we do is that dog, when all these kids are running around, any dog, in my opinion, a family pet, but especially a service dog, should go somewhere, lie down, and watch the kids walk around. This dog should not be loading on the kids. The dog should not be aroused by the kids. The dog should not want to jump on the kids. The dog should actually not want to actually even go over to the children. Because if it's a service dog, it should only be paying attention to you. So what do you want to do? Proper training equipment on that. Get yourself a prong collar. Teach that dog place. Teach that dog what no means. And the dog absolutely shouldn't have access to the kids at all. And please don't discount when you say it's no big deal or something. That it's a I want you to know it is a humongous deal. It's a humongous deal. It's actually a deal breaker. So if this was this dog in a service dog school, it would be kicked out. Next. Oh, there's a super chat. Yep. $4.99. Dog works. How much is a 1 hour Skype new business question chat with you, Jeff? Do you offer this kind of, yeah, I make a, actually, that's actually how I make a living. I do business consulting. So I just booked our, I didn't book the flight yet. I didn't ask you about flights. I booked the Airbnb in Austin. Actually, it's not in Austin. It's outside of Austin. Leventon or something. Leventon.
What is that?
23 through 27 of January. Yeah. It's a three day consulting gig. And we've got a day before and after to fly. So yeah, you can the cheapest way to do it is by joining my Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. And you can either do a 15 minute or a 30 minute Skype, or you can also do a 1 hour Skype by going to my website, solidcaninetraining.com, and Skype. But I do a ton. I'm doing anywhere from 3 to 5 Skypes a day. Next.
Betty Jane Brain. I adopted a 7-year-old male beagle. Pet Supplies Plus sold me harness. Well, I returned it for the prong collar, and the girl tried to tell me I was going to hurt my dog.
Okay. Well, you can politely say to go.
Oh, hold on.
Oh, sorry.
I pulled up your video and showed her the contrary. I also had the manager watch it. Toodles from Akron, Ohio.
Yeah. So you could also tell them to go fuck themselves. And what I would do is I would call corporate. And I would tell them about your experience. And I would like to know why they sell prong collars if they refuse to, why they carry them if they refuse to sell them. Hey, Kira.
Good night, guys.
Good night.
Good night, Angela.
Good night. Love you. We're on YouTube.
Good night, YouTube. Okay.
Good night, you all. Good night, buddy.
Take care. So what I would do, and also, yeah, that's pretty unethical behavior that they do. So I'm glad you figured it out. And, because a harness is designed for pulling. If you want to do bite work, tracking or weight pulling, harnesses are fantastic for. Next.
Karen. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. You mentioned that most training is best with very little to no talking. When you're not in structured training, do you tend to still limit talking, like with day-to-day activities? It just seems like too much talking might be confusing to dogs.
Thanks. I mean, I don't mind if you want to tell your dog all your problems, go ahead. I see a lot of excess talking with dogs, which just confuses the fuck out of them, because then they don't know what's a command and what's not a command. Next.
Calvin, when giving information for staring on an e-collar before arousal, would you use high stim or low stim?
Historically, if you've got a leash reactive dog or an aggressive dog, at the first sign of arousal, I historically give a very firm punisher, because I want it to have a lot of meaning to it. Once the dog already is on the elevator of arousal, the stairway to arousal, Led Zeppelin, they if you go back to the 70s, Led Zeppelin did do a track on that. And not too many people have access to it, but it is on Musical.ly. So it's the stairway to arousal. So what I would do is I would just stop it immediately. Next.
Betty Jane Brain. Tomorrow I'm making Bonker, as his barking is out of control at the window.
Yep, you can make a Bonker. It's easy to do. In fact, why tomorrow? Why don't you do it tonight?
Next. Right now. Jillian Anderson, how do you decide what size prong to use on your dog? I'm using a 2.25 Herm Springer with 3 additional links on a 75-pound Catahoula. Works great on him, but I'm starting to work with friends' dogs, finding the 2.25 to be very versatile, even on a 110-pound lab. Thoughts?
Historically, we do a 3, but I mean, ideally, the 2.25 is a fantastic size. So if you can get away with a 2.25, the only thing is, as you found out, you're going to be adding links to it. Next.
Tiffany, hey guys, happy Wednesday. I've been watching clips from the last show I missed. I missed a good one.
Yeah, hey Tiff, how are you?
Betty Jane Brain. I purchased a 2.25 for Harley, the beagle. He is 30 pounds. Pet Supplies now understands how to fit the dog properly from your video.
Yeah, you know, it's like, I mean, you sort of have an obligation. If you're going to be a store carrying product, it's up to you to be knowledgeable about all the products so you can then pass on the proper information to your client base. So you should know everything about it. And it ain't rocket science. It's not rocket science out there. If you think that prong collars are going to harm dogs, then why the fuck do you carry them in your store? That's sort of the most idiotic thing that I've ever heard in my life. It's like, yeah, hey guys, over on aisle 5, halfway down, is where we have all of our harmful tools. Oh, and if you use your Pet Supplies Plus card, we'll give you 10% off. It's idiotic. And it's no way could it be corporate policy. And if it is corporate policy, well, then that's a bigger problem. Next.
Dog Works. How much is a 1 hour Skype session with you to discuss new business type things?
Anywhere from, usually business Skypes are $250 an hour. But again, go to Patreon. You'll save some money. Next.
Betty Jane Brain, your methods for keeping dog attached or in the same room has helped immensely. He stopped going to the bathroom in the house.
Say that one more time. I was reading the one that was that someone says, do you suck your tits of your wife? And I said,
where do you see that?
It's on mine.
Oh, it's nobody, because Melissa got rid of it.
It's been hidden. So this is Joelle. So that's not my wife. But if, as far as you want to know of a general response, I'm very much attracted to my wife. And I will put my mouth on every single part of her body from head to toe. So I hope that answered your question. Next. What was the actual question now?
I don't know. I lost my spot. Betty Jane Brain, your methods for keeping dog attached or in the same room has helped immensely. He stopped going to the bathroom in the house.
That's usually the best policy, is wandering dogs usually do stupid stuff. Next.
Bo Boatner, your internet presence touches many, including my after-school animal club for elementary kids. Tips on handling, etiquette, etc. as part of our agenda and much influenced by you. I just clean up language a bit. Ha.
Good. So, Bo, yeah, I'm glad you do, because I shouldn't say that. I actually speak to 4-H groups, to elementary school groups. I can actually go into an elementary school. I work with I love special needs children. I love children in general. And actually, if I was to go into a school, obviously, I would tailor my language very, very appropriately. I don't do baby talk. I don't dumb down things at all, but I absolutely will definitely do a way better job of with my enunciation as well as my choice of words. Why don't I do it on the show? I just can't help it sometimes. I don't think I do it for dramatic effect. I obviously don't do it for ratings. I actually lose viewers because of my potty mouth. I just can't help it sometimes. Next.
Candy L. Hi, Jeff. I have a 2-year-old Dobie who goes nuts when he hears someone outside of our house. If I correct for excessive barking, will this make him afraid to bark at all?
Well, you know, first of all, you're forecasting a future that may or may not happen. What I would say is, why do you want your dog? First of all, no, it won't. But why would you want your dog to bark? Like most of us don't want dogs to bark. We really, really don't. And I would say that 99.9% of the time, your dog's barking is not necessary. It's not necessary. So next.
Top chat,
$4.99. Megan. Hey, Megan. I was going to say, God, who's that beautiful woman in that little bit of an icon, that little lobe, that, what is that called? Thumbnail there. Fair to use prong with long line. Dog is not off leash yet, and so free time is on long line. Just wondering if that confuses them. No, you can do it. You absolutely can do it. Because the long line, there'll be no tension on the long line. You don't want constant tension on it. But you can also put it on a martingale. Just put it on a martingale if you want to. Next.
Betty Jane Brain, good night.
Good night.
Good night, Betty. Alex, just got a new dog. When I give a command, both of my dogs respond, even though I say one's name first. Can I fix this? Nervous about correcting for it and messing up the command for them.
Yeah, what I would do is this. You have to teach them. So you haven't taught them name of dog command. So what you do is you put one of your dogs on a tie back. Tie back is put the leash to something firm. And then you would call your dog to you by name, and if the other dog moves, I would use a remote collar, and you can actually correct that dog. Plus, it can't move because it's on a tie back, and then it'll start learning how to recognize name and then dog. You can do that. Next.
Do you want me to read this next one?
Which one?
Suzako 23. I'll skip it.
Where is it?
I don't know. Where are you?
I don't know.
All right. You're not in the right spot.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Next.
Calvin King. Born and trained German Shepherd has an elderly owner who is unable to use an e-collar after it's done with my 6-week training course. Your thoughts?
Oh, I see what the one was. Now I just put them in a timeout. Yeah, Melissa's not on the show tonight. Born and trained German Shepherd has an elderly owner who is unable to use an e-collar after it's done with six. I would want to know why. Why can't the elder? I would. If anything, first of all, if this dog has an owner that can't use a remote collar, the owner shouldn't own the dog, because that should be the easiest part of their day. So they're if they don't have the dexterity to push a button, then how are they going to do basic animal husbandry with the dog, such as feeding, walking, putting any sort of collar or leash on the dog, anything like that. So I'm a little bit, I don't quite understand. If anything, elderly owners, the remote collar is actually the saving grace of dog training. It's actually like a fantastic tool. Now, will the dog do well? That all depends on the owner, your training, the dog, the relationship, which usually is toxic, their skill set. There's a lot of variables. But I would almost be like, if that dog's doing all this training on a remote collar, I don't want you to use your relationship to, I've talked about this many times. I don't want you to use your relationship to train the dog. I want the tool to train the dog, because if you use your relationship to train the dog, the owner does not have that same relationship. The dog won't listen to anybody but you. So we really want that dog to understand the tool, so then the new relationship can be formed. So, you know, you'll probably have some backslide. Next.
Frank, just a simple hello, Jeff, from British Columbia.
Hey, Frank, how are you?
Matt, how would you introduce a dog to other dogs in the household? I have a pit bull and an English bulldog, and the pit bull keeps snapping at the English bulldog. Thanks.
So you end up with a dog fight, most likely, if you don't stop it. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it could be just play, but I would get a bonker. A bonker is a, where the hell is my bonker? Oh, here it is. A bonker is a cotton towel. So if I had a dog and was snapping at another dog, I would say no. And then I would just throw the bonker. It's just a towel. It's not going to harm the dog. I would throw the towel at the dog. But also, are you creating the dog separate? Where's the human in all of this? I always say, it's like, hey, where's the human in all of this? So you definitely want to advocate for both dogs. One of these days that, you know, the bulldog's probably going to be sick and tired of it and probably, you know, aggress back possibly. So I don't want to see things escalate. So let's put a little bit more structure and consequences into the mix. As far as introducing them, I introduce dogs a little bit differently on my own personal pack. I'm usually like, I just jump right in. As far as like, I don't slowly do it. I quickly do it. If there's going to be a problem, I know how to take care of it. I'd rather straighten things out on day one than have things build up over time and me not recognize it. But with you, what you can do is you can start migrating with the dog, meaning walk your dogs, have them in the same area. Don't try to have them be best friends. Try to get them to exist with each other first. Next.
Matt Henson. Oh, I just read that one. Gal Jez. Hey guys, it's been a few days with no leash reaction from my dog, thanks to you and the mini educator. When will I know he's past it?
I don't know. The dog might never be past it. They're dogs. Kira shit in her kennel area 2 nights ago.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yep. She took a dump right by the door. Yeah. I woke up in the morning, went to the gym, came home, and it might not have been her, but it looked like one of hers. The great thing about raw food is that it's like barely anything. It looks like goose poop. You know what I mean? Big, huge German Shepherd looking like goose poop. I mean, you actually pick it up with your, I've actually picked it up with my bare hands. I did that day, but I've actually like picked up shit with my bare hands because it comes out dry and crumbly. I wash my hands obviously afterwards. You know, dogs, I mean, that's like, I don't think she's done that for about a year. You know what I mean? I mean, dogs make mistakes. They make, you know, they make mistakes. So I don't look at it as like a big deal though. I'm like, you know, I just got to monitor, make sure I like think about her eating and her, when did I let her out, you know, last. So, but I don't know when your dog's going to be over it. You need a lot of repetitions though. Next.
bitless equestrian. I want to learn a bit about people aggression and reactivity. I've seen many videos about it, and I just want to hear your opinion on how to get people aggression out of a dog.
Well, that's a 12-hour show. It's a 12-hour show. If it was that easy, then I would be like, that'd be pretty incredible. You know, you have to punish the behavior, that's for sure. As far as getting it out of the dog, you're actually just suppressing it. It's still there. Aggression is there. We all have aggression in us. All of us will kill. And if any of you out there say you would never kill anybody, please don't have a family. Okay, because I would like to think you would kill for your family. In a minimum, I'd like to think you would kill for yourself, because I sure as hell would, without blinking an eye, with no remorse. If you threaten my life or my family's life, you will die. And it's not a political statement. And I'm not, you know, and I'm not a violent person. I've only been in two fights in my life, and I'm 53 years old. I've mastered the art of no conflict, believe it or not. I strive for that. But we all have aggression in us, and so do dogs. What you want to do is you have to put a very strong inhibition, you know, into the dog, and you make it suck to be aggressive. And that's going to be a combination of learning how to properly apply punishment, to there might be some management, to also understanding the level of expectation that the dog actually can meet. Every dog can't be rehabbed either. So it's a very long process that we do. It's very, very involved. Next.
Bitless question says, I do use prong and e-collar.
Cool.
David Smith. Hey guys, just saying howdy. I'm sure I'll end up with a question. LOL.
Oh, cool. Awesome.
Hey, David. Betty Jane Brain. Should I use a Barker breaker collar or an e-collar?
Two different applications. A bark collar has one purpose. It stops barking. That's what it does. And you don't need to be there. A remote collar can be used as a bark collar, but you'd have to be there to apply it, or a remote training device, which is a fantastic tool. So all depends on your situation. If the dog is barking and nobody's home, then a bark collar works. If a dog has a remote collar on and the dog barks and nobody's there to hear it, then it won't work at all. Next.
Monoxide, just curious, Jeff and Joelle, what's your favorite breed of dog?
I don't know if I'm drawn to German Shepherds. I don't know if that's my favorite breed, though. You?
Same. Yep. Shepherds.
Next.
Betty Jane Brain, will Bonker stop Harley the Beagle from barking?
All dogs but Harley get stopped. So it stops Polly, Max, Frank, Cindy, Spot, but Harley will continue to bark. But I have no idea. I absolutely have no idea. You can try it. You know, you can try it. It all depends on, you know, how well you understand punishments and how you know and your skill set on the bonker, which is not that hard to have. I would just get yourself a bark collar if you wanted to. But if the dog barks and you say no or quiet, and then you throw the bonker at the dog, it should stop barking. It should stop barking, no matter what the breed or the name of the dog is. Next.
Calvin, I know the elderly owner shouldn't own the dog. My thoughts exactly.
Yep. Next.
Bitless equestrian, what do you think about bark collars?
I'm a huge fan, so you must be brand new to my world. I've been talking about bark collars publicly since I've been training dogs before anybody talked about electronics. So 14 years ago when I had my radio show, or 13 years ago when I had my radio show, I was talking about shock collars very openly, and people were afraid to talk about them. Bark collars are fantastic. I would challenge anybody to stop a dog from barking when nobody's home. The dog is home and it barks. I would love to know how you would stop a dog from barking without a bark collar. Next.
Tiffany G, when my dog was a few months old, I was in a pet store looking at tools, and two random strangers got into a screaming match at each other over the unsolicited advice they were trying to give me. One was a purely positive person and the other was recommending a prong. I grabbed my dog and escaped. They didn't even notice I was gone.
Yeah. Well, so the world is filled with assholes. That's just the way it is. They're everywhere, even in pet stores. Next.
Life of the Doberman. Can I punish my 7-month-old puppy after he break trees?
Well, I don't understand what that means. What's breaking a tree? Do you mean like
breaking a tree?
Like, what do you mean? Like chewing a tree? Or what's breaking a tree? I never heard that. I don't understand what breaking a tree is.
I don't know.
state that, please. Life with Doberman.
The nice shrubbery outside of the house.
If it's an unwanted behavior you want to stop, then yes. Next.
Lou, in terms of leash reactivity or prey drive, how much higher up should I instantly dial on the e-collar from their working level if they've gone off at something somewhere? Hi from New Zealand, by the way.
Hey, New Zealand. How are you? Now, the thing is, once the dog has gone off, you're sort of screwed. You better just hold on and get out of there. Like, you got to get your dog out of there because you sort of missed it. The goal is to start recognizing, and it's not necessarily connected to the prey drive. Leash reactivity and prey drive are two different things. You're going to have a highly leash reactive dog that's not a high drive dog. So what you want to do is recognize it at the first signs of it, and that's where you want to apply your punisher. Once the dog is already escalating, it's really, really hard to do. It's very, very hard to do. What do? Oops, my timing was wrong. Let's get the dog out of here, and then let's set it up again. That's why we train. You set up for all these scenarios. Next. Oh, this is Top Chat 499. I know you teach no mouth from pup. I've always been in the soft mouth school of teaching problems with this. I know there always have been two schools. I mean, I can't imagine I don't teach forced fetch at all. So I don't teach a dog to hold an article at all. But to me, I'd rather extinguish the behavior as far as unwanted. So and then if you wanted to teach the act of either doing bite work or tug, which I do, I play tug with my dogs. I do bite work with my dogs. Or if you want to teach them to hold on to an object for like service dog stuff or for forced fetch, you also can. Next.
Red Riding Hood and the Wolf. The other night I was training my dog and my neighbor was filming me without permission. She said I was abusing my dog and that's not how you train a dog because I stepped on the leash to make her lay down.
So everybody's a fucking critic. Oh, well, that's fine. I mean, if that's what it's a free world. If that's, I don't know what the laws are about that, but I really don't care. I mean, if your neighbor wants to film you, if that's what your neighbor wants to do with their time, well, then that's on them. Well, then that's on them. It sounds like you got an asshole for a neighbor. Next.
Monoxide, if the poop is coming out dry and crumbly, you're probably feeding a little too much bone. I feed raw too. Glad to hear you feed the same.
Actually, I haven't, but good. That's good. It's I have been doing a lot of bone, but you're right. So definitely on nights that they have turkey necks or chicken quarters, it's definitely more. But historically, I'm feeding them mostly ground beef. Or pork. So there's not a lot of bone in there, but absolutely on days. So this might've been like the day before or 2 days before when they had, a chicken quarter or a turkey neck, but yeah, definitely, higher on the bone there, but I don't do bone usually more than once a week. Next.
Sweet Caroline. My Aussie is faster than my bonker throwing arm. Do I step up to e-collar?
I would definitely get an e-collar. Next.
Bo Boatner, dog generally treats other dogs appropriately depending on other dogs' personality and size. Does this come naturally for some dogs with minimal intervention?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think some dogs have it. Yeah. I think some dogs are just good greeters. You know what I mean? I think some dogs are good greeters. Absolutely. Maybe they just had better socialization when they were younger. Maybe you give them you gave them direction. When you didn't think you were giving them direction. So yeah, definitely. I mean, I've seen just naturally dogs that are just naturally good with dogs and puppies. You know what I mean? So next.
Gettable Rescue, large dog lady with first Chihuahua foster, 10-year-old history of biting. It's been a week. I've seen a lot of teeth, mostly with toy guarding. I think guarding his crate, buries into blankets in the crate. Any Chihuahua tips and advice?
Yeah, well, it's not a Chihuahua thing. It's just a behavioral thing. So none of my training is based on breed. It's all, you know, so what I would do is for resource guarding is pretty simple to stop. You keep the dog on a leash. And if the dog, you know, growls, I would use a bonker. So if a dog showed its teeth around a resource, so if a dog was chewing a toy and I walked up to it and the dog growled, I would say no, and I would take the bonker. A bonker is a towel, and then I would just boom, you know, I would just go like that. Next.
Mermaid, I got a new puppy, but my older dog has attacked her when she walked past him in place and also on potty breaks. I've corrected as high as 100 with Dr. IQ, but he will still repeat the behavior.
So number one, the Dr. IQ is a pretty low level collar, but still, what'll happen is if we don't stop this, that puppy's going to be really fucked up. To me, you know, I'm not there. you know, I'm not there, but this has to stop immediately or else you'll have a major problem on your hands. What's going to happen is right now that dog that's attacking shouldn't have any freedom whatsoever. So this is a pretty, the answer to this is we're going to be really, really long, but right now let's just keep them safe. They can't be out together. Let's make it really easy. They can't be out together. That's not the answer, but my obligation to you as a professional trainer doing a show that's rapid fire, the advice I would give you is that your older dog needs to be in a crate when that puppy is out. And also it cannot be being reactive in the crates. So that's really, really important. To fix the problem, it's a way, way, way more involved. Next.
Katie Toll, I never catch you live. This is awesome. I have a 1.5-year-old American staff. He's been e-collar trained and prong collar trained. He's over all our standard puppy issues except the car. When we go in the car, he ends up drooling and panting. What am I doing wrong? Do I make him down? The passing cars definitely excite his prey drive. Any suggestions? Love you. You changed my life with this pup. Can't thank you enough.
Awesome. Good. Thank you so much for the kind words. Yeah. So, well, you know, one of the things is the dog should absolutely be in a down. So drooling, we can't stop. That, you know, I don't know, maybe put your clothes on in front of your dog and stop sitting in front of your dog naked. It'll stop drooling. But other than that, you know, we really can't stop drooling. So what we do, though, is this. We see all car behavior, all is wide paintbrush stroke, pretty damn close to 100% of car nonsense. Everything from car sickness to drooling to panting to nervousness. We see that organically get eliminated when we put lots of structure into the dog's life. And then all of a sudden you go for a car ride, you put the dog in a down and it goes away. And that's because also you're practicing a lot of duration downs in the house, outside the house. You're putting a lot of structure on the dog. And we just see it go, away organically. But for starters, absolutely teach that dog how to lie down in the car. Next.
Holly, howdy from Arizona. No more effing excuses. Late to Q&A was outside e-collar conditioning anxious dog. Finalizing a 1-page contract before bed to use and charge next client this weekend.
Okay, Holly. That's good. Holly and I had a Skype today. All right. Let's go.
No more excuses, Holly.
No more fucking excuses, Holly. Procrastination. Paralysis analysis. Okay?
Time to execute.
Let's go. Next.
Max Asina, what bark collar do you recommend?
I like the Garmin bark limiter. And then I also like ECollar's new, what are they calling that?
I don't know, but they're great.
Yeah. The ECollar.com makes a good, they might be the only one they carry right now. It has a little digital odometer on it. Their bark collar. Next.
Greg says, coffee mug, the world is full of assholes.
That's probably already been made. But all right. We'll do that.
We'll put it down.
Yep.
I would drink out of it.
Yep.
Bitless equestrian, how should I punch a dog? I know I should, but I just don't really know how.
I can't give you advice on punching the dog. I'm not quite sure why you should. So you're asking the wrong guy. So, I mean, I would bonk a dog, but there's, you know, and I can't tell you that I've never struck. I have striked my dog. You know, I've given a swat on the ass before. And I've given it a swat on the, on the nose before, but I'm not sure that I can responsibly give you advice on how to punch your dog. So let's go to the next question.
Melissa. Hi, Jeff and Joelle.
Hey, Melissa. Hey, Melissa. I thought you weren't going to be here. Hey, Melissa, how are you?
She couldn't stay away. Chemo. My dog let out some gas and scared himself. Come on. He ended up running upstairs into a room. Should I punish him? For running around upstairs. I'm sorry.
No, you shouldn't punish the dog for running around. You should probably change the dog's diet, which I would do. Or, you know, I'm surprised the dog didn't blame it on you, actually. What you should have done is taken the blame for it. You say, hey, dog, listen, I'll take this one. I'll take one for the team. That was actually me that farted, and you're okay. Usually it's the reverse. You always blame your gas on the dog. That's one of the benefits of having a dog. I love being in a room full of dogs. I can just fart all I want, and I'm just like, that you know they're going to get the blame for it. So what I would do is I would just keep your dog on a leash, but you wouldn't punish the dog because you didn't tell it to down or place. So as far as if the dog scared itself, it ran upstairs, it freaked itself out, just call it back to you. Just call it back to you. That's all. Next.
You too. How do you transition from prong to a choke chain, martingale, or slip lead? Currently training my Akita to walk nice on a lead. I've tried a slip lead, choke chain, but he ends up choking himself.
Right. Don't. Why would you want to get rid of this? You own an Akita. I've owned Akitas, and it doesn't make a difference if I've owned them or not. You know, why would you want to get rid of a tool that works? And the reason is because you think a choke chain, which by the way, choke chains choke dogs. It's hard to walk a dog on a choke chain. It's extremely hard. Choke chains, everybody thinks that prong collars damage dogs. They look barbaric, but they don't damage dogs. And I've seen the two photos online, and that was not from dog training, by the way. You know, I've seen them, trust me. But I bet you there's probably a million people that are using them right now. So but a choke chain actually, so choke chains, so flat buckle collar, martingale, which is called a limited choke, slip lead and choke chain, all four of those collars actually constrict the dog's airways and absolutely choke the dog. Actually, a harness could actually choke a dog too because of where the harness usually sits on the dog. That actually can cause some pretty good damage too. But why would you want to get rid of a prong collar because it works so good? Don't transition off of it. Keep using it. Next.
Mm-hmm. Red Riding Hood and the Wolf. This same neighbor tried to come for me over a $95 vet bill because her dog overextended its shoulder. She said if I didn't pay, she'd go to her lawyer. I started laughing because lawyers are more expensive. She can't afford a vet bill. How is she going to afford a lawyer?
So it's like I said, it sounds like you've got a major asshole for a neighbor. So there are a couple ways you can do it. Is you can ignore it, or you can just kindly go over to your neighbor's house, and you can say, hey, listen, you seem to be harassing me. Maybe you're not realizing you're harassing me. Maybe you think neighbor's supposed to do it, but it's not acceptable behavior. And I would like it to stop. And if you want to film me and send it into the newspapers or the radio or the TV stations or to the SPCA, and if you want to threaten me that you're going to sue me because your dog pulled you down or whatever, that's fine. But just stop telling me about it. So do me a favor. Stop telling me what you're going to do. Most people that tell you they're going to do something don't actually do it. So doers do. Fakers say. So what I would do is I would just read them the Riot Act. And I'll say, listen, like, let's be good neighbors and leave me alone. Next.
Jetif88, Jeff, any workout suggestions for me since I'm no longer doing tension workouts walking my dog since she stopped pulling on the leash using your DIY?
So, Jenny, you actually want to talk to Joelle? She's a personal trainer. I don't know shit. I just listen to her. Next.
Karen, are things like structure, limiting affection, and proper punishment help one to become a better leader to their dog? What else would help?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds, first of all, nobody got a dog to be less affectionate. They didn't. We didn't. But all I know is this, the one common thread that every dog that comes into us has, the one common thread that every single dog with bad behavior, everything from separation anxiety to leash reactivity to outright aggression, the common thread that we see over and over and over again is way too much affection, no rules or structure, no consequences, which is, you know, and then the proper application of punishments. That's why dogs are messed up right there. It's not because people are abusing them. It's not because people are mean to them. Not many people are abusing their dogs, guys. They're not. There really, really isn't. There is animal abuse laws in every single city in the United States, and I imagine in the world. And there's an animal abuse registry in most states, and not many people are on them. So the biggest thing is all the things that you mentioned. So you'll be a better pet owner. Absolutely, the more structure that you have. Now, affection is, when we say affection, there's unwarranted affection. I'm not against affection at all, but most affection is unwarranted and it actually can reinforce a lot of unwanted behaviors. Next.
Karen. Oh, I read that one. Jillian. Katie told, my Catahoula would drool excessively, bark at trucks and buses while in the car. I thought it was because we transported a lot in that car when he had parvo. Turned one and the drooling stopped.
Look at that.
Look at that. David Smith, I meant soft mouth even when playing in the yard. I do teach tug and release too, but when play gets rough, I shut it down and try to teach gentle so they learn their strength.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to that. It sounds like you know what you're doing, David. So keep going with it. I'm just a big fan of family dogs not putting their mouth on humans. Next.
Melissa says she got home early. Glad to be here.
Oh, awesome. Thanks.
Mew 2, thank you for the advice. It is such a great tool. I live in the UK and they got a bad rep here. I try and avoid and make sure it's not visible.
Yeah, things in the UK are a little bit out of control right now. So, you know, I would tell everybody in the UK to start stocking up on your tools in case they do put a ban in effect. But I do consults with people around the world in countries that tools are illegal and people are still using them. So bandanas, and they also make collars that can hide the tools. Next.
David Smith says, at Bitless, whew, you had us worried. Tiffany, when you do board and trains, do you bring dogs into your home, your trainer's home, to teach inside manners?
No, Tiffany, all the dogs, they don't need to. I'm not bringing client dogs to my house. You know, I used to, they used to live here, and my trainers, and for liability reasons, I don't want my trainers taking dogs home either. So all dogs stay on the property, they go off property, and they're underneath the care and control of my trainers when they're on the clock. But you know, what I want people to understand is a dog can learn proper etiquette no matter where it is. It doesn't have to be inside of a home. Next.
Monoxide, we want to take our Rottweiler to the lake and swim next summer. She'll be a year old by then. Can she feel the e-collar in the water?
Dog tra and e-collar technology, those two particular, because I use those are waterproof. Those are waterproof. And then the handset on the e-collar technology floats. So obviously that's waterproof as well. So they can feel it. You usually have to go up higher though. So because it doesn't shock the dog. So your levels usually have to go up higher because the water dulls the stim historically. Next.
Michael, any recommendations for a muzzle that would work on a French bulldog?
Yeah, I would go. They make a bully breed muzzle website. There's dogs. There's muzzles for like boxers and for Frenchies that and bulldogs that are very breed specific. And I would go to that website and get one specifically designed for that breed. Next.
Monoxide uses the e-collar technologies 1200.
The 1200, yeah, that's waterproof. Next.
Bitless Equestrian, what do you think about gentle leaders?
I'm not opposed to a gentle leader at all. We really don't use them. As long as people understand that a gentle leader is not like a more of a humane tool than a prong collar or a remote collar. You know, that's the only part that I want to make sure that if folks are saying that they're practicing force-free or positive reinforcement dog training and they're using a gentle leader, they're full of shit and they're lying and they're being ignorant. But I'm not against any tool, actually. I'll speak out that like choke chains can choke a dog, but if you want to use one and if you get great results from it, keep using it. If you can fully train the dog on a martingale, that's fine. But what I have seen over and over and over again is dogs pull on those tools, even the slightest bit, which is creating pressure. Next.
Mm-hmm. Jamal, e-collar just came out with a concealer.
Oh, good. Good. Oh, nice.
Interesting. Liz, my Malmix loves the UPS man. We're on a farm. Okay to allow others giving treats occasionally?
I'm not opposed to that. But I just don't know what the treats are. You know what I mean? There's a lot of crappy treats out there. Also, do you want your dog to take food from strangers? That's personal choice. Next.
Sean, 18-month female Roddy. Your help with place has been so helpful. Thank you. Question, thoughts on the gentle leader over the nose versus prong collar for walks? We are working on not pulling, especially for wife.
I would say whatever works best for you and the wife. You know what I mean? We don't train with them, but I'm not opposed to them. Like I mentioned before, I mean, I'm not opposed to really any tool. If it works for you, if it works for your wife, if she's comfortable with it, and then absolutely use it. I'm looking for humans to have a better quality of life with their dog. Next.
Greg says, how difficult was that bringing client dogs home?
Well, I had the board and train in my house. So, it wasn't actually in my house, they were during the day they were in the house training, but they stayed in like an outbuilding on my property. It was fine. A lot of young dog trainers, and new dog trainers have their boarding trains out of their homes. I think there's a huge benefit to it. Next.
Jillian, moving to Colorado in the next couple of months, any exposure to the Colorado dog community in terms of what training methods they utilize? Want to ensure I will find like-minded individuals out there.
Yeah, it's sort of like being gay and you move to a new neighborhood or you move down south where you think that homophobia is rampant and believe it or not, there's a big gay community, or being Jewish or being, remote collar trainer. I'm not going to put them all in the same thing. The fear of the unknown is always scary though. So I think that there are, number one, I believe we live in a wonderful world with wonderful people. I believe that I can only speak of, I've traveled the United States extensively. I'm not going to discount that there are certain countries obviously will kill you over certain things. But I think in Colorado, you definitely have got your share of people that are anti-tool and pretty outspoken about it. But then again, you've got a big community out there that actually doesn't give a shit, especially now that pot is legal. They don't give a shit about a lot of stuff, obviously. So next.
Jillian, I just read that. Monoxide, have a good night. Thanks again. Love the show.
Awesome. Thanks.
Greg says, Jillian, I'm in Colorado, both positive and balanced.
Yeah, there's Greg's there. Look him up. Next.
Yeah. Bitless Equestrian, what setting do you mostly use on the e-collar? The vibrate, the shock, which do you mostly recommend?
Well, we don't use a vibrate at all. I'm not opposed to it. It's not variable. You can't go up or down. And it freaks out a lot of dogs. Because sometimes you need lower levels, so we use shock only. And then there's different ways to train the dog though. So everyone's got their own different training methodology. So you've got to find what works best for you, but be careful about vibrate because when a dog's in drive, they're usually not going to feel it. Next. And you can't go up on it and you can't go down on it. It's just one level. Next.
Melissa. Hey everyone, hit that red button to subscribe and tap the bell to get notifications for Jeff's next Q&A.
Thank you so much. You can make sure you hit the subscribe button and then hit the notification button. Next.
Yeah. Michael, when you first started training dogs and had no one working for you, how many board and trains would you do at a time?
I think I did about two or three at a time. Next.
Crod 279, when using the prong collar on a walk, how can the dog find a spot to poo or pee when you keep the pup next to you, as you show in your previous videos?
Well, it's not just the prong. So Crod, it's got nothing to do with the prong collar. Healing a dog next to you is healing a dog next to you. So it's not even a prong collar conversation. The concept is the dogs that are on walk should be working. If you want to do a casual walk, which I do as well, my dogs are out off leash. My dogs are off leash 90% of the time. So, what you do though is when you're out on a structured walk, how does your dog go to the bathroom? So it's not even a prong collar question. Because if I train dogs on any tool, I would still want my dog to be healing next to me. Because that's what proper training etiquette is. On the walk, in heel, dogs are next to you. There's no sniffing. There's no marking. There's no turning right, no turning left. They follow you. When you stop, they automatically sit. That's just proper sort of like a structured walk. What you do though is you stop at a potty spot. You stop at a potty spot, and we teach this all the time. And we do this with our, the dogs on our property will stop and take a break. We decide when it is, unless the dog all of a sudden puts on the brakes, and then we're going to stop for them. And you just find a little spot, whether it's a patch of grass or whatever, and you give the dog the leash, the 6 feet of leash, and you say, go potty. And then you just have the dog, and the dog goes potty. And after about 30 seconds, you're just like, okay, let's go. And you put him back in heel, and you go. So it's more about a healing, proper healing, no matter what the tool is heel. Next.
Bitless Equestrian, what treats do you mostly use? Which ones do you recommend?
We don't use treats, but you can use the dog's daily food. That's what we do. We food train, but use whatever motivates the dog if you choose to. Next.
Rachel Lee. Jeff, you're absolutely right about asshole neighbors. I witnessed mine punching his dog in the skull with a raised and closed fist. I called the police. They came and did nothing.
Yeah, because it's usually he said, she said. Next.
Bo Boatner, friend has 8-week lab that bites. What should they do?
The friend should probably reach out to a trainer. So, you know, this is the way I look at it. It's an 8-week-old puppy. It's called puppy biting. Almost all 8-week-old dogs put their mouth on humans. That's just what 8-week-old puppies do. So what I would do, Bo, is I would have your friend research the fuck out of dog training, because all 8-week-old puppies do it. So it's normal puppy behavior. It's normal puppy behavior. So they're going to be on a very long journey where every day with that dog is a learning experience. So what I do with a young puppy is if a young puppy is nibbling at me, I'll take my thumb and I'll stick it in the dog's mouth and I'll push it down. But the bigger thing is your friend needs to start consuming massive amounts of how to raise a puppy information, because they're raising a dog, not a puppy. And there's so much information out there that they should be doing. Next.
Lori, how long should my snotty dog not be allowed on the furniture or anything? Is that forever or will he eventually stop being snotty?
So Lori, so keeping the dog off the furniture won't make your dog not snotty, but let's fix the problem before we worry about how long. Does that make sense? So I have no idea how long your dog is going to be snotty for, because I don't know what your skill set is. I don't know what your skill set is. So just keeping the dog off the furniture, remember, you're not keeping the dog off the furniture as a punishment. You're keeping the dog off the furniture because theoretically it has no right to be on the furniture because it's being snotty. But you can stop snotty behavior really, really quickly, but keeping the dog off the furniture doesn't do it. The proper application of punishment is going to do it. But that's also personal choice. You can let that dog up on the furniture anytime you want. That's up to you. That's up to you. Next.
David Smith, going to dinner. Have a great night, guys. Love ya.
Oh, have a good time at dinner, David.
He also responded right after, so he obviously is not at dinner yet. Yep. Oh yeah, the thumb and mouth thing is genius. Wish I knew that long ago. Yeah. Oh, well.
Sort of. That's the basic stuff. Yeah.
Enjoy your dinner, David.
Yep.
Karen, I walk my dog twice daily. If I pre-bonk before each walk, would he become used to it or begin to expect it? They are such creatures of habit. Your thoughts, please.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, you could turn your dog into a nervous dog. We only pre-bonk. You shouldn't have to pre-bonk before each walk. We usually just pre-bonk.
Scratch your little face.
Hold on, here. Kira, here. Place. You guys are all mixed up over there. Tex, go to that place. Come on. Place. Kira, here. Place.
Oh.
Yeah, Kira lost her bed. Plots. Good. Okay. Sorry. Three dogs. One of them probably was, I didn't even pay attention to where they were. So what you want to do is the pre-bonk is mostly used for leash reactivity. So once you get a handle on that, you should be also working on your leash handling skills, your remote collar healing skills, but you shouldn't be pre-bonking before every walk. Like that's usually a 1 or 2 time thing. Next.
I see Big Sky, snot, snotty, snuff, sned, LOL. Yeah, you got me. That's a tongue twister. Mm-hmm. One purpose.
Did you say that?
Yeah.
Oh, when?
No, I didn't say that.
Oh.
No, I think she's making a joke.
Oh.
I think.
Next.
One purpose says, "What's up, guys?"
Hey, One Purpose, how are you? Next.
That's it.
That's all the questions we got. Oh.
Sure, they'll come in.
Oh, cool. So, let's see. Instagram stories. We just put up our We just answered all of our AMAs.
Yep, here they come.
Did all the AMAs today. I'll load those up tonight. Did you send me an image?
No, but I will.
So send me an image. I'll get the AMAs for everybody that doesn't know what AMA is. Let me just answer this top chat here so we don't lose it. 18-month-old female Roddy, hyper-focused on kids, especially babies. Not sure if it's aggression or interest, desire to play, but we manage by crate. Next steps, training for correcting. High stims are ineffective things. So, yeah, I don't know either. I'd have to see it. I mean, a lot. It could be – I would need to know more about – don't answer these questions now because we don't have time to go over them. But, you know, it could be just interest. It could be just interest. So, you know, I have no idea what the dog's intentions are. I don't know the dog's behavior at all. So what I would want the dog to do is definitely learn how to exist around the child. We have pretty big, strict training protocols for baby proofing. You can actually go to 7 days of sanity, to, I've got an online streaming thing that you can get there. You can try the code GIRL, G-I-R-L, or Kyra, K-Y-R-A. I think those will give you 25% off, if I recall. 7 days to sanity. What did I say? 7 days of sanity? Seven days to sanity. What you want to do, though, is if the dog is having ill intent towards the baby, you definitely want to eliminate that. You can use a remote collar for that. And what it is you're eliminating the dog loading up on the other dog, and that would be that intense. That would be that intense stare. As far as the question, someone asked a question that I told them that I'd get back to. No, what's up, guys? Oh, Rasmus, we're at Rasmus now.
Yeah. Oh. Hey, Jeff, thanks for the bonker tip the other day. My one-year-old Staffy is doing great again.
Oh, cool. Awesome. That's really, really exciting. Next.
C-Rod, what's a pre-bonk?
A pre-bonk, well, a bonker is this. This is a bonker. So the way a bonker gets used is, and you can go to my videos, go to my YouTube channel, and there's a video that I just put up on how to make a bonker and another video of how to use the bonker. So it shows you how to use the bonker. People that have a leash reactive dog, what I tell them to do is before the walk or before they go out on a walk, what they would do is bonk the dog, which sounds really harsh because the dog's really not doing anything wrong. But what you're doing is you're getting the dog to be on alert, you're alert of you. Because what's happening is the dog is on alert of everything else out there, of everything else out there. So what I want dogs to do is I want them to be a little bit more concerned, not afraid, but concerned about me. And what happens is when these dogs are leash reactive, they end up tuning the owner out and they focus way too much on the environmentals. Now, that's just the punisher part of it. Now, once you're on the walk and the dogs are paying attention to you, that you do mark that and you say, you know, yes, good. And you can actually give a food reward. So step one is what everyone usually forgets. So what everyone's trying to do is they're trying to do step two first, which is get the dog to redirect over food. But if a dog has its eyes on an environmental, that's usually not going to work. Next.
Rasmus, but he is afraid of driving, I think. He's in the back seat and jumps to the floor, shakes, and sits down. He's not barking. He is on a dog seatbelt. What would Jeff do?
He's afraid of driving. I think he's in the back seat and jumps to the floor, shakes, and sits down. I mean, your dog might be afraid of driving, so you can always put him in a crate. I mean, to me, it's not the worst thing to have your dog on the floor. If he's shaking, you really can't do much about that right now. The floor, though, vibrates. Remember, guys, floors of vehicles vibrate, so there's a lot of motion on the floor. We normally don't feel it because our feet are our feet either don't touch the floor or our feet don't take up as much surface on the floor. So a dog, though, is spread out on the floor, and they feel every – and most cars on the underbelly are not insulated really well, so they tend to feel every single vibration that the car is making. So it usually can make them a little bit nervous. So you can always have your dog get up onto the actual back seat and lie down there. Next.
Ice-Ski Big Sky, good night, guys.
Good night.
Good night. Karen, have a good night.
Oh, thanks, Karen.
Jimmy, I'm a big fan of Jeff. Jeff's methods have helped me so much. I was a very newbie, but since I watched Jeff so much, my dog pretty well better trained than lots of my friends who own a dog for years.
Yeah. Jimmy, congratulations, buddy. So thank you for the nice words. This is the thing is that you can own a dog for 5 years and it doesn't know shit. Like, right? I mean, how many of us have had teachers that have been teaching for 20 years, but they suck, you know? So longevity doesn't equal good. Same with trainers out there. There's a lot of young trainers out there that are doing extremely well. So the thing is that most people, the average college student, what is it? 80% of college graduates never pick up another book again. So, and in my opinion, most education happens after structured universities. So what I want, you know, folks to understand is that the information is out there. So what I would do is follow not just my videos. Excuse me. God, these 4 a.m. mornings, they catch up to me once in a while. They do.
Catch up to me every day.
Do they really? Stop working so hard.
I can't.
Okay. So I would you know, watch tons of free information out there and just apply. Work your dog every day on something. Next.
Mm-hmm. Melissa posted your Instagram.
Oh, yeah. Check out Instagram. We do a lot of Instagram stories.
Fun stuff. You guys want to see me freezing today. It's on there.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Were you freezing?
Yeah.
Why were you freezing?
I made a little video on stories. It's 24 degrees. That's off property.
That's not that cold.
You could see my, that was the video. You could see my breath. It was that cold.
It doesn't have to be that cold to see it.
You're going to go watch right now?
See your breath? No, I'm going to go check the temperature tomorrow.
It's really cold here in New England.
Oh my gosh. No, it's not.
Yes. 20s at night. That's
cold. It's freaking New England. Give me a break. Yeah.
Look at that. 22, 18.
Oh my gosh.
It's at my elbow.
Give me a break. But people up in Canada and Russia are going, are you kidding?
Yeah.
Are you kidding? Like, that's not cold.
That's pretty cold.
All right. All right.
All right. Alex says, thanks, guys.
Oh, you're welcome.
Michael, Jeff, I just want to say thank you for publicly speaking out on the truth about shelters. Most people don't realize that they really would rather put a dog to sleep than have it trained.
Yeah. I mean, you know, whenever I talk about shelters, It's a lot of it's a wide paintbrush stroke that, you know, most shelters suck. They don't give a shit about the dogs. They're just worried about their fundraising. They don't know anything about animal behavior at all. They don't know how to, you know, most dogs don't come out of shelters better than they go in, but they've got in-house trainers there. They always complain that they're underfunded and understaffed. And whether that's true or not, they're just also, it's because a shelter does not have to be understaffed. If a shelter was more open to actually rehabbing and training dogs, you'd actually get some good people in there. But the problem is they've got an agenda, which is works against the dog doing well. So no problem.
Melissa posted your 7 days to sanity and your Patreon.
Oh, cool. Thank you so much, Melissa. Yeah, Patreon's a lot of fun. Next.
Jedif, dog was terrified of the tub, used your leash pressure and troubleshooting advice, and in 15 minutes was able to calmly get in and out. Such a rewarding feeling to be able to create and get results. Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, well, kudos to you, Jeff. You're doing all the hard work. And this is the thing. What Jeff was doing was, and it was most likely, if Jeff used his emotions too much, he probably wouldn't, or she probably wouldn't have been able to follow through with it because the dog was probably panicking. But I'm a big advocate of just working the dog through the issues really, really quickly. Because most issues the dogs can be. And the way I look at things is like, why would we want a dog to struggle for longer than it has to if we know that it could be quote unquote fixed or rehabbed in a more expedited manner. So good for you. Next.
Mm-hmm. Bo Boatner. Would you say a couple of initial 180s would work like a pre-bonk?
It'd be different, but try. Yeah, definitely try a couple of things and see what works. Next.
Jimmy, started training my dog with ECollar 2 weeks ago. I want to stop my dog from barking when I have gathering in the living room, but I'm afraid if I punish her like this, she'll be scared of barking.
Well, yeah, somebody mentioned that earlier, Jimmy. I mean, most dogs don't need to bark. They just don't. Oh my gosh. God, now I'm getting rude here. I'm being really rude and impolite. So yeah, most dogs don't need to bark. Your dog's barking at a gathering. You really don't want your dog to bark. So let's 90 something percent of the time your dog barks, it really doesn't need to be. So let's just stop the barking. Next.
Matt, I have a 4-month-old puppy. No sit down, stay. Next steps?
Well, I mean, forever. You got a 16-week-old dog. You know, keep up with that. Don't stop. Start adding distractions and duration. So adding in different environmentals and then also in different environmentals from the outside coming in, and then put your dog in a different environment as well. And then also start working on duration. Next.
Rose Montave, is it okay for dogs to wear sweaters?
Yeah, of course it is, especially if they're cold. Damn right it is. can wear yourself a sweater. You can have a little Pucci Vuitton sweater if you want to, or a, you know, I don't care what it is.
Are you going
to
get one for Tex? You said you were.
I don't know. Maybe someone will get him one for the holidays.
Maybe.
Hint, hint. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, I would get a nice little fleece with some a nice little flannel or a nice little, you know, the nylon on the outside. And sure, get your dog a sweater.
C-Rod, Jeff, you're training us, man. Thanks for all that you do, really.
Oh, you're welcome. One thing about sweaters for dogs, get the sleeveless ones, though. You'd think that the ones with sleeves would be more warm. The problem with sleeved jackets, dogs' legs are always getting stuck in them. So what you want to do is whenever you're getting a garment for the dog, get a garment that actually hugs so it looks like a tank top. So you want all the armholes cut out, all the armholes. We used to manufacture dog shirts, and we always manufactured them with our the armholes. And we'd see the ones with the sleeves, but dogs are always, especially your small toy breeds, they're always pulling their arm in there because Fabienne is always getting out of her sweater. She's always a little bitch. She's always getting out of her sweater.
Fabienne, yes. Keep your clothes on.
I know.
Jillian Anderson started using Mini Educator on Stim with Prong in the last week. Dog's healing perfectly. He trots right next to me with head up looking at me. I think he's looking for praise. When I look down, he either gets a good rub on the head. Anything further I should be doing to reward this awesome behavior? He's totally looking for my approval constantly.
So Jillian, now, you know, I mean, this is the thing. I think it's a little bit hard for your average pet dog trainer and pet to do food training right then and there. I think, and telling your dog, like, when I put it this way, Jillian, here's a great example. When your dog's in a room and you're not in the room and you walk into the room, does your dog get excited? Does it wag its tail? You just showing up is a reward. Always remember that. So your presence is a reward. So what I'd like you to do is absolutely just tell him, good boy. It's a boy or a girl. It doesn't say, but you know, good dog, good boy, good girl. Do that. Just say, that's a good boy. Give him a little bit of a head thing. You can do that. That's a good boy. Do that.
Okay. That exact
that's
tone
it.
Of voice.
I want you to make it. I want you to make that your ringtone. Ready? Ready, Jillian? Make that your ringtone. That's a good boy.
God, got it? I feel nightmares.
Let's just do that.
All right.
Yeah.
Lou, hey guys. Oh, hey again. There are loads of bunnies where we walk. I do bonk our dogs before we even go to discourage them from taking off after the bunnies or stim on the e-collar when they notice at a higher level.
Yeah. That, damn right. That was a question. Yeah, absolutely. You want to make chasing bunnies suck. Unless you want to have some fun. I mean, so this is what you want to do. Let your dog kill enough bunnies till you get this. All right. Until you get this, and then stop the killing. Unless you want to get into the wholesale hat business.
Or raw feeding.
Raw feeding.
My dogs would eat bunnies.
Then kill the damn bunnies all day long. There's usually an overpopulation of bunnies. So there's no shortage of bunnies historically. But yeah, I would put the dog into because the bunny can go through a lot of places that dogs probably shouldn't go. Like they can go through fences and they can go out into the street and they can go, you know, into interesting places where you might want your dog to run to. So I definitely would put a stop to that.
Rick Maloney, will you be doing T3 in Providence in 2019?
Yeah, and T3 is also train the trainers. You can go to T3 seminar. Yeah, we do it in June and October, I believe. Yep.
Lou, also 4 a.m. That's crazy.
What's also 4 a.m.?
I don't know. I think she asked a question prior, but now she's just saying like also 4 a.m.
Yeah, that's of course. Crazy. Most successful people get up at 4 a.m., don't they? Yeah.
That's my norm.
Yeah, shit. There's awesome shit to do at 4 a.m. Just watch podcasts. Oh, I got the book today. Did you see the book that I got in the mail today?
No, but I saw you reading it at your desk.
Yeah, during lunch. And I started listening to it tonight. David Goggins. Guys, you guys want a good book?
Some people can't see that.
Oh, I'm sorry for David Goggins can't hurt me. So I'm holding up on Audible. I love Audible. Ah, love it, love it, love it. I got that one recently, and I got This Is Marketing. The three books that I got queued up right now are David Goggins' Can't Hurt Me, which I'm listening to for the first time. I just got it. This is Marketing by Seth Godin. Great book. I love Seth. And then the 12 Rules for Life by obviously JP Jordan Peterson. I'm on my third time listening to it. So those are the three. Those are the three that I've got in the queue right now, and I'll put those on rotation next.
Zachary, is your recommended age for starting a puppy on an e-collar at 14 weeks based on their physical growth or the psychological state of the dog's life?
Definitely not psychological state of the life. Most dogs at 14 weeks old are dragging their owners down the street. It's more about human comfort. Human comfort. Next.
Holly, thanks for everything as always, especially the obvious kick in the pants I needed to hold myself accountable and get shit done. Hugs and mad love. By the way, it's only 56 here. Only.
Awesome. So Holly, it's funny because Holly pays me for me to semi yell at her respectfully.
Didn't I do that too?
Yeah, she did. And then you started working here. Yes. Yeah. Next.
Rasmus, but when I take him to the dog park and I'm alone in the car, he won't go up to the back seat. And if he does, he go back down and there's no space for a crate in the back. If I take him to the front seat, it's the same.
So obviously, first of all, stay out of the dog park. Dog parks suck. But obviously your dog is not comfortable on the seat. It is more comfortable on the floor. I'd leave it alone. I'd leave it alone. Next.
One purpose. I found a new way to work my GSC. I have him crated while I'm at work. When I get home, we go in the backyard and I let him chase squirrels on command. He absolutely loves chasing them on command. I let my dogs chase on command.
Awesome. One purpose. It looks like, sounds like you got it all covered. Good job.
Elaine, 24 and sunny. You are cold. LOL. Cut the crap. JWS. What's that? I'm good with those things. JWS.
I don't know what JWS is. My acronyms suck.
What is that? Let us know. Looks. Jimmy, my dog is confused about sit and down since she was a puppy. And now whenever I said down, she will sit first, then correct with down. How can I fix that?
Train, do lots of sits. Just train your dog to do puppy push-ups. So put your dog into a sit, say down, dog goes down. Teach it then to go to a sit from a down. So just do puppy push-ups, they call them. Next.
Toxic Shiba. I feel like when my parents are giving me overly high expectations when it comes to me training our dogs and I'm not professional, and honestly, it makes me feel like garbage. What should I tell them?
I would tell them exactly what you just told me. I'm not sure how old you are, Toxic Shiba, but you know, what I would do is a lot of parents are trying to create children that underneath what they want to be doing, not what the kids want to be doing, which, I mean, I've got seven kids and I'm far, far, far from a perfect father. In fact, some of my kids probably think I'm a terrible father. But I've also learned a lot in the last 30 years of me, almost 30 years of me parenting. What I would do is I would sit your folks down and I would say, you know, when you're putting all this pressure on me, it makes me feel. So remember, it's important that you say it makes me feel. So they don't do it to you. They can't do, people can't do stuff to you. Always remember that. So it's how you feel about it. It's how you feel about it. And the cool thing about that is it can't be wrong because those are your feelings. But I would tell them that, you know, it really makes you feel that there's a lot of pressure, and then see if they're open to the conversation, and also find out why. Like, what's their why? Like, you know, what's their why? Sometimes, I'm not sure what your age is, but sometimes kids just don't also understand what the why is because the parents don't tell them what the why is. So maybe ask them what the why is. Next.
Sweet Caroline, do you have any opinions on dog parks?
Yeah, I think dog parks suck. I think that they're dangerous. I think that they're toxic. I think that most of them, most unwanted behaviors start and are reinforced at dog parks. But I've also seen 10-acre dog parks that are pretty much just like enclosed areas. And I probably wouldn't feel that about those places. But your average dog park in a city environment is, you know, at the smallest, 500 square feet and probably an average of maybe 5,000 square feet. And that's all pretty small in my opinion for a dog park, especially with the amount of dogs that are there. Dogs can pick up all kinds of different diseases there. You don't know the medical history of any of the dogs. You don't know the, the behavior of any of the dogs. There's no sheriff there. It's pretty much a free for all. Next.
Have you seen the ones out in Colorado?
They're probably big.
Huge.
Yeah. Yeah. It's more amazing. It's more like an enclosed area. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Different.
Tiffany, I volunteer at my local shelter and found out that they put a dog down because he had been returned for chewing everything up in sight, and they would have had to be crated for the rest of his life. Was livid.
Yeah. I mean, so this is the thing, is that that's typical. Number one, your average shelter doesn't know how to stop that. So that's a good example of the mentality. We can stop crating with a shock collar. We can stop chewing with a shock collar. But chances are that shelter would think that would be mean. And this is the truth. For anybody out there, there's something called death before discomfort. Death before discomfort is an actual thing that a ton of the population thinks, but I would say majority is 51% or more. That would be majority. So we're talking at 90% of animal shelters and rescues most likely feel that using a shock collar on a dog for chewing is inhumane, but that putting the dog down would be an acceptable thing to do. Truth. Next.
Russ says, add dog sweaters to the new merchandise line with your quotes on them.
No, maybe no. Let me work on t-shirts and coffee mugs first. Okay. We're trying to get these damn things up. Next.
Yep. Rose Montave, I'm getting a black sweater that says security for my 5-pound chihuahua.
So that was one of my t-shirts said security on it for chihuahuas. I did an extra, extra small. So I had a company called Doggy Style Designs where we designed, manufactured, and wholesaled dog t-shirts with slogans. And we had, a couple hundred minimum slogans on them. Next.
Elaine, Jeff would say JWS.
Oh.
Cut the crap.
Oh, got it.
Got it. Jillian, Joelle, where did you take your dogs hiking this week? Instagram pics.
Oh yeah.
That was Lincoln Woods State Park.
Yeah, which is a little jewel here. It's not far. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Sweet Caroline. Excellent. Thanks for your dog park input because it validated my own feelings. Love you all.
Oh, cool. Toxic Sheba.
Where? Oh, right there. Sorry. I'm 19 and I have multiple chronic illnesses, including a pretty bad anxiety disorder. I'm also on a treatment similar to chemo. I enjoy training dogs, but not when I have a lot of pressure from parents.
Yeah. So what I would do is, I don't know your folks at all. This is it. I truly feel that parents want their kids to be happy. It might not appear it. It might be like, geez, Jeff, my parents want me to, then why do they keep doing everything that makes me fucking miserable? Touche. I really feel that parents want their kids to be happy. Like if you tell your parents you're going to become a lawyer, they're happy. If you tell them you're going to become a dog trainer, they're like not happy. Meanwhile, I make 3 to 4 times the amount of money that most lawyers make. You know what I mean? So it's like my hourly rate is higher than probably 75% of lawyers out there. So there's no glory in being a dog trainer, obviously. So, you know, most parents would be like, oh, geez, you're a dog trainer. So what are you really going to do for a living? But a lawyer, oh, my God, you're great. I mean, even a basic medical doctor is not doing well these days, right out of medical school, especially. And with all kinds of different insurance premiums that they have to pay, it's really hard to be a doctor in most parts right now. So I think they want you to be happy. It's possible what they're doing is this might be their defense mechanism for some of the issues that you're struggling with. This might be their defense mechanism so this could be a good family therapy thing. You know, I don't know if they're open to family therapy, to family counseling, but you might want to talk to them about it. And you might want to sit down with somebody so you can start opening up some really good communication paths. I think most people don't actually know how to truly communicate with each other, especially spouses, but then also parents and children, they don't know how to communicate with each other. And there's a lot of hidden anger, and there might be some hidden anger. There might be guilt. There might be, they might be angry with themselves. Your sickness may or may not have anything to do with it. So what I would do is I would talk to them about it. I would really talk to them about it. All right. Talk to them about it. Next.
Jillian, Joelle, Colorado will be our dog park. ECollar has created such liberty, but we will definitely be visiting those dog parks.
Awesome.
Nice. Sweet Caroline, I read that one. Rose Montave, what happened to your dog sweater business?
It actually was a dog t-shirt business. I stopped doing it. I stopped doing it. About 2004, 2005, I had an adult company called Miko Exotic Wear. Google it. Miko Exotic Wear. I had a few companies back then. I had Erotic Books for Less. I had an adult auction site for discontinued adult products. I had a dog sweater company, a dog t-shirt company. I was a sweater dog t-shirt. I had a few businesses, and I shut it all down to train dogs because I was burnt out. I was burnt out. Next.
Toxic Sheba says thanks.
You're welcome.
Tiffany, they also feed reward dogs with endless treats while their dogs are lunging and barking at other dogs and other volunteer handlers out in the yard.
Sigh. Yeah, so Tiffany, it's time to get out of there, and it's time to find a shelter / rescue that might appreciate your skill set and that you more align with. Next.
Bitless Equestrian, hey, I'm back.
Oh, hey, I don't take it personally. I didn't even know you left. I didn't know you left, so...
Toxic Sheba, I'll try to talk to them about when I can tomorrow. Thank you for your advice.
Oh, you're welcome. Good.
And Gupsters G, my dog is starting to shake her head as if she was being stimulated with the e-collar, even though I'm not pressing the button. For example, if I were to say heel, she would shake her head. How to fix?
Yeah, sometimes they do that. Sometimes they do that. It's sort of like a, I don't know the proper word for it, but they'll do it. So the more... You can work your dog through that. You can work your dog through that by, but I've seen dogs do that for, you know, I'm just trying to think, dogs that have done that, and have they always done it? No, they haven't. How did we stop it? I think it just organically went away. I just think organic went away.
Yeah, he said maybe muscle memory. Is it a big deal?
It's not the biggest deal in the world. That is why a lot of folks will use, they make a double collar. It's not because they want it to be twice as strong. It's just sometimes because it gives a more even stim and it doesn't always cause the head shake. That's one of the reasons why it gives a, so it's not just one-sided. So it's from both sides. So, but anyway, our time is up. Our time is up. So it's time for us to go, which means it's code word for it's time for us to go, which means it's also code word for Linda wants the house shut down at 9:30. And I say that with love. She's not this holy terror that is going to come in here with a frying pan saying, get this fucking show off the air. I'm trying to get my sleep. You know, it's not like that. But happy wife, happy life. And I think it's really, really important. That sweater looks good on you, Jeff. Oh, this.
I'll read one more.
This right here.
As long as you're going to compliment the sweater. So
I love this. So whenever I fly international, I fly first class. So I was fortunate that I was on Japan Airlines. And if any of you have ever flown Japan Airlines, they definitely take care of you. And this was actually, I'm actually wearing the pajama bottoms.
And slippers.
And I'm wearing slippers. The slippers are not from them, though. The slippers we got on the road. We got them at Walmart. But I'm wearing the pajama bottoms.
Get up.
the pajama bottoms and this top. And this top is, I love it. I love it. And it was a great flight. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, oh, yeah. It's really nice. It's really nice. Yeah. So I love it. I love this. So, yeah. If you ever have the, you know, if you want to plan an international flight, what I would tell people to do is get a second job. And if it's important to you, it's just fun. You know, when I went to Australia, I can't imagine going to Australia in coach. And that sounds snobby, but it's like, that's a long fucking flight. And especially if I have to go there for work, it's like, you're exhausted. It's just an exhausting flight. So being able to upgrade is always really, really nice. But actually, I used a first class ticket broker. It wasn't bad. You know what I did? When I flew out to Seattle, I flew Boston to Seattle on JetBlue, and I did their mint status.
Yeah, and it got delayed 100 times.
Yeah, but by the way, I got like $500 in freaking credits to JetBlue. We'll use that for our flight to Seattle too. But actually, it wasn't much more expensive. If you catch you can get the flight at a good. You catch your flight at the right time, you can get a really good deal. All right, everybody, it's time for us to go. Make sure you subscribe to our channel, hit subscribe, and then turn on your notifications. And thanks for joining. Let's say Wednesday. The next show we're going to be doing is Saturday night at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It'll be Saturday night. I get on YouTube Live. And make sure you follow us on Facebook. Follow us on Instagram. Go to our website, Solid Canine Training, solidcaninetraining.com. And that's sort of the portal for everything we do. All right. Madly in love with you guys. Thank you so much. Joelle, thank you so much for doing the show tonight. I really appreciate it. And take care. Bye-bye.